Mug effects. Zoom, you like the zoom.
That was so bad. I had nothing right in that angle. It was too close. I was off to the side. My goodness, that's terrible. Good morning, friends. There's your morning. There's your Wednesday morning trumpets for those of us that need to be eased with a nice brass band into the Wednesday morning, the middle of the week. Good morning, Brett. How are you?
I am well. I am well. Good morning, everybody in the chat, and good morning to our very special guest, Carla Torgerson. How are you?
Good morning. Good to be here.
Well, thanks for joining us.
Seems like we just saw you.
I know, right? Back at ATD 2019, which they used to call ICE, which somehow flowed off my tongue a little bit better. But yes, it was fun to see you guys and be at the bookstore with you guys.
Yeah, we had a good time. I hope everybody, did you guys in the chat watch that particular episode? That was fun. We like to be on site and do idiotic at a different location every now and then. So ATD always, they were gracious enough to provide the bookstore as the location for us to hang out with everybody. So good times.
I think we look smarter just by being surrounded by all those books.
Yeah, that's it.
It made us look smarter. So,
well, I think you guys had a run on mugs, did you not? You had 10 and they were gone like lickety split.
We did.
Yeah, it was fun to send lots of folks home with some of these prized possessions and off and running. So, yeah, mugs are fun.
They are a hot commodity, I must say.
They are. They do seem to be.
Yeah, sadly, I was supposed to bring one to Brandon Carson last night. I hung out with him and Michelle for a little while, and I woke up this morning, and I don't know why it all of a sudden dawned on me, but I was like, oh, yeah, I was supposed to bring a mug to Brandon last night, and I totally forgot. Cool. So now we're going to have to mail them one before I forget.
So I'm curious. I know that you are in the Phoenix area, Brent, and I know that Brandon's over, I believe, in Atlanta. So what brought you two together? What were you guys talking
about? Oh, Chief Learning Officer Spring Forum in Scottsdale.
Oh, very cool. Yeah. Very cool. I always like what he has to say. Very smart stuff.
Yeah, it was fun. Yeah, it was a good time. I sort of crashed the event. Nobody was looking, so I snuck in and just sort of sat down. I knew four or five people that were there. So I hung out in the morning, and then I bailed, and then I went out to dinner with Brandon and Michelle later last night.
Nice.
But it was a good time. And actually, super smart people. So, I mean, lots of great folks in the room. Got to meet Kevin Yates for the first time. I don't know if you guys have seen him on LinkedIn and Twitter and whatnot. Super cool guy. Presents on data and learning in the L&D function and whatnot. So, anyways, sorry. We're totally off topic. and out there, I'm certain there were plenty of people there talking about microlearning. I just didn't stay for the whole thing. So, we're
going to do that. Yeah. Well,
your time is limited.
That's right. We only had 3 minutes to catch the video on microlearning, and then we cut it off. Anyway, speaking of super cool people, we do have Carla Torgerson with us. So maybe we'll do the introduction portion of our program today. Carla, tell us a little bit about yourself for those folks who haven't either met you or encountered you in the virtual world yet.
Sure. So my name is Carla Torgerson. I am currently Director of Instructional Design at a place called Bull City Learning, where we do interactive, engaging e-learning, micro-learning, mobile learning, also some ILT and VILT work as well. Prior to that, though, I have a kind of a long history in consulting and doing a lot of work with ATD and I've done a lot of work with interactive e-learning. I was at Allen Interactions for a long time. And then I was at Maestro doing mobile learning for a while and had some times on the inside side. So I got a sense of the pressures as well. And through all of that, got really interested in micro-learning. And I was just looking over that way because I thought I had a copy of my book over. Hold on. It's here.
You gotta have a copy of your book. Medium,
I know. I'm like, I should have been much more prepared for this conversation. This, if you have seen it, is my book, The Microlearning Guide to Microlearning. And so I've been doing a lot of work and exploring and talking with people across the nation about microlearning and what they're doing, how they're using it effectively. And so along with good interactive learning of any sort, microlearning is one of the areas of interest for me.
Very cool. And we did have a bit of a chat about that at the ETD that we were talking about just a little bit. But we've got a bit more of a more focus, for today. Mm-hmm. I guess we're starting to think about moving into or looking at things that they may call microlearning, things that they can do as they're looking at the content that they need to work on.
Yeah. So I think for me, there's some real value in really thinking about how you're planning to use microlearning, and I think we get ourselves kind of muddled up a little bit by putting everything in this bucket of microlearning without really thinking about how we're going to use it. And so for me, it becomes a lot clearer if I look at the four ways you can use it. The first one is as pre-instruction, right? So if you've got some sort of a classroom event, that before that you would do, you could have some microlearning for preparation. You could also use microlearning as after the instruction, right? So performance support, things like that. You can also use microlearning to stand alone, right? Which would be what most people think about and where I have a strong interest. And then the fourth is using it to augment instruction, sort of. Again, you've got that face-to-face. You can have it right after the moments of instruction for support and reinforcement. So there's a difference between that and performance support, right? So more of the reinforcement and keeping it top of mind. So those are the four ways. And so I usually tell people, think about what you want to do with micro first. Is it that you've got a classroom event and you want to support people really well because you could support them before or after? Or is it that you've just got something that stands alone really well on its own and you want to just keep it short, right? Or, of course, the fourth is the performance support. So, are you going to use that to support them potentially in place of doing any instruction?
Mm-hmm. And three of those...
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, three of those four... also fit very nicely. I think it's implicit in what you're saying. Three of those four really do fit into very well into in supporting the idea of spaced repetition too. Yes. Being able to, as you're saying, something before and then during and then after, et cetera. And yep. So, as part of a formal learning process, but taking spaced repetition in that way, fundamentally as part of the process of your design.
Yeah, and especially that post-event stuff, which Brent has here as number two, that really fits well, right? I think even for me, having done this job for a long time, I've had times in my career where I got really frustrated. I was like, man, is what I'm doing really making a difference? Am I really helping people? And I think that follow-up post-instruction can really make a difference, right? Because sure, one time of instruction, it's only going to have so much impact. But if we can continue to follow up, like you said, the spaced learning and repetition, that's where it fits the best. But you're right, the pre-instruction supports that as well. And even the performance support, which Brent has there as number four, can fit very, very well as that sort of repetition and getting them to a place where they can do it automatically without any training or support afterwards.
Yeah. Hey, they got 9 out of 10 on the quiz in the LMS. They clearly know it all and never need any more info.
Right. So that reminds me, oftentimes I also teach the microlearning certificate program for ATD. And in there, I often ask people, would you do a quiz at the end of your microlearning? And of course, it's supposed to be a softball. And most people get it right in saying, absolutely not, right? Because if you do 3 minutes of instruction and then ask them some questions, it's all recency effect, right? They remember it. Fantastic. But will they remember it tomorrow? That's a bigger question, right?
And so you could even consider using questions as microlearning,
right?
Trigger. So at the end, so the post-event instruction and the spaced repetition afterwards, instead of shooting them the content, just shoot them a question and let them answer the question. And it takes all of about 30 seconds. They get the question maybe on their little watch thing or on their mobile device, wherever they're at. They see the question, they can tap on it, immediately answer it. If they happen to be at their desk and they have more time, maybe there's a link to send them to more resources and information just in case they happen to be kind of now in the groove and they want to read more. Or they just answer that one question, boom, it triggers some recall and they have had that one short experience and now they move on to whatever they were doing before until the next one.
Yep, absolutely. And, you know, certainly we can do these sorts of things even on our own, but there are great systems that you can use to support those sort of things. So Exonify is one that I know well. QStream is another one that I know well. And I know there's lots of other players in that market, but yeah, you're right. You know, having some sort of a way that, you know, either you log in to your terminal, whatever it is, whether it's like a cache system and it asks you a few questions before you get started, or if it's, again, your watch or your phone or your laptop. The one thing that I really like about Exonify, and I think others are doing it too, but I'm just most familiar with their product, is they also, when you answer a question, they ask you to rate your own confidence on your answer, which actually gives them two data points, right? They're finding out if you were right or wrong, but they are also finding out, did you think you knew it or not? Because those are two extra data points that are really invaluable, right? Because if you know that somebody is absolutely sure of themselves and they are wrong, you've got a problem. Right? As a manager, you need to check in on that and talk to that person, or, you know, have additional opportunities to check in on them, or training, or whatever it is, right? You just don't want somebody who's convinced of a particular answer and then they get it wrong. And then the flip is also really important too, right? The person who's always right, but not confident and always thinking that they are wrong. You know, those things are really actually really important for us to recognize as well.
These are the, I think microlearning is going to be really important in gathering all of those data points for AI, right? AI is the big buzzword, and data collection and data analytics and all that kind of stuff. I think it is the microlearning elements that people take that are going to be supplying a lot of that data for the AI algorithms to start making better and more interesting decisions and to help people a little bit more closely, I think.
Yeah, I think so. And I think especially as we start looking at more informal learning and tracking of that. So, you know, and I'm really torn on that because, you know, if you look at systems like Degreed, again, not a sales pitch for any of those firms because I don't know, I don't work for them. But, you know, Degreed is one that I know well. It's your informal learning platform, right? Or, you know, your opportunity to go in, it's like an LMS, but nothing's required, and you're following other people that you respect, and you can learn from what they're learning from, right? A learning experience platform. And I think that's where data will become really valuable to us as well, what people choose to learn when it's not required. I think it's going to still be an interesting space for a long time because I think when there's, as I look at it, when I'm at work and everybody is in the same camp, right? All people who have a job, their first priority is to do the job. Their operational duty is the first priority. And so training will always come second. And so informal learning is just a really tough situation, right? We all are doing it. But when something is really important to the organization, making it required actually gives it a level of priority that helps to balance it against operational duties as well. So I think that space is still sort of shaking out. A lot of people are excited about learning experience platforms. And I am too, like, don't get me wrong, right? I'm excited to see where that goes. But I'm also, I've got my little quizzical hat on of just like watching and waiting to see, you know, and I know some people are all on for informal learning, like nothing should be required. I get it. I love that idea, but I'm a learner, right? I love to learn and I love to talk with other people and learn from them. And my informal learning is actually really high because that's my personality style. But when I am busy, I may not be learning the things my organization thinks are really important.
Yeah. If you're gonna perform surgery on me, I really do value the formal learning that you have put in place.
Yes. Right. Right. That I know that there are certain standards that have been met. Yeah. And now I see, Mark, you say that you're using Degreed at your organization. You've got some interesting possibilities. And I think you're right, right? There's some really neat things, especially for ongoing learning. And especially as they aggregate content from all over the place, right? So you've got a wonderful library that's curated and you can pull from, which saves us a lot of time as designers.
What's a good industry where microlearning lends itself maybe not better than other industries, because I think everybody can benefit from it, but have you seen any sort of implementations or anything of really, really good micro learning? Then it was just like, wow, yeah, I can totally see this being huge in this particular audience or this industry.
Yeah, I think one of the ones that has always had me really enamored, I've seen a couple examples of people who used it for compliance training. And for me, that's really exciting because, you know, most of us, what was that?
Because people hate it.
Right. That's exactly it. Right. I don't know many designers who actually like design and compliance training. And I don't know many learners who like to take compliance training. Right. So if we can shorten that up, everybody's happier. But more importantly, from a logistical perspective and an operations perspective, again, we get them away from priority number one for just a little bit of time, and then they're back to their job. And so I think there's all kinds of pieces there, right? The organization is happy, the learner is happy, and as designers, we're happy. The interesting thing also, like if you think about it, right, you do 1 hour, you know, I used to work in a health organization. And so we did compliance training. We had 1 hour once a year where you had to learn about basically everything about HIPAA, staying safe with, you know, with needles and, you know, just it goes on, right? If you're in healthcare, there's just a lot of compliance topics. And I always felt like after a year, I'd probably forgotten everything. And if it wasn't already part of my natural behavior, I probably wasn't following those rules anymore. Mm-hmm. And I was probably getting sloppy about things like slips, trips, and falls, or, you know, how do I solve certain problems and challenges? Like one of the big ones for us was always, if you find a chemical spilled on the floor, what do you do? Because in healthcare, there are a lot of chemicals, right, and things. And some of them you absolutely don't want to touch with a bare hand. Right.
Always get on the floor and again sniff it really good to see what it is first before you talk to anybody. That's a good rule of thumb.
Right. So I always felt right. Thank you, Chris. Yes. So I always felt like if we could just do 5 minutes a month, we would actually do a much better job of keeping that top of mind. And in the year, we'd still do our 60 minutes.
Right.
And we'd have none of those employees who are like, oh, man, I got to do my compliance training. Right. Which happened all the time. Right. Nobody wanted to take it. And for our hourly stuff, we had to figure out how to fit that in when they were already sometimes working overtime. And, you know, so it was really this challenging balance. So I do know of some organizations that have done some pretty neat stuff with microlearning with compliance. I will say in my organization, though, when I tried to do that, I got a lot of pushback because, yes, Brent, it's all about tracking, right? Mm-hmm. The compliance people want to know that you did it. And for us, that one
microlearning, right?
Yep. But in our case, what was going on was if you didn't complete your compliance training, we could fire you. And so they didn't want to have to do that. And so they would follow up with you like about 6 times. They'd follow up with your manager. And my compliance team was only willing to do that once a year. And they said, if you do this every month, we won't be able to keep up. Now, it's an interesting dichotomy, though, because nobody was doing there was challenges in getting people to complete their compliance training because it was long. It was boring. People didn't see the value. I think if we were doing 5 minutes a month, we actually probably would have done better. And again, I've seen really positive examples in I saw a retail one that did this really successfully with some point of sale content, which is like credit card safety. Yep. And I saw another one in financial services that did it well. So I think you just have to have the right organization to let you try it too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then gather that data.
You brought with you today some questions then that we should be thinking about as we're assessing our content.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so let's transition into that and share some of that with folks.
Absolutely. So what I'm going to ask everyone to do is, first of all, for those who are in the chat, think about something you design training for. Okay, something where you might be thinking, hey, maybe micro might fit. What I'd like you to do is, first of all, I'm going to make this like participative here. Think about something you design training for. Type it in the chat. I'm curious what everybody's working on. So I'll give you a minute to do that.
Looks like Donna's works in healthcare and feels like it's going to be a challenging task. And I think in organizations, any sort of change is a challenging task. And then it, messing with existing systems and processes can often be very challenging. And my advice to people all the time is just start small. It doesn't matter what area you're in, pick something that's low impact to start off with, and just, you know, because if it goes wrong, it doesn't bother anything about the business. The business still runs. Like, you don't break stuff. So pick something that's got a low risk but high reward. If it works, then people see it and go, oh, we should be doing this over here and we should be doing this over here. But if it goes badly, people are like, oh yeah, it was done just in that one area, which really isn't all that important anyways, so it's okay.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, right?
Take the small, less challenging areas and test before you move out into the larger world of your organization.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Or even just make small changes. Instead of having an hour e-learning, make it 2 30-minute things. And, you know, if people are really torn on, you know, going shorter, you know? Yeah, and I love your point, Brent, about, like, going in areas that are less concerning to the organization. Again, my organization compliance it ruled a lot of areas, and changing up their process was going to be very difficult. So excellent. I see a lot of things are coming in the chat. Lots of people doing lots of different topics. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. So the first one is, as you think about designing training for that, now I want you to think a little bit about the performance challenge that's being addressed in there, right? Like, you guys gave me topics, which is fantastic, right? That was the question I asked you for. Now what I want you to think about a little bit is, within that, what is the thing you're really trying to fix? Or train to the behavior, the performance you're trying to achieve, okay? So you can put that in your mind, right? So, you know, within your new employee orientation, what is it you're really trying to achieve? It's probably an affective goal. If you're doing accounting things, you know, what behaviors are you after? Medical insurance, clinical process, all that, right? So get to that moment where you're thinking, this is the performance I'm after. Now, my question for you is this. I'm just going to give you a series of six questions, as promised, and you'll see where micro might fit for you. So the first one is, if the training is compliance related. And I was saying before, I think when you have compliance options, that's a great place to go micro. You might have some process issues and some people to get on board with it, but it will be the best low-hanging fruit. Everywhere that I've seen try it, that's been able to get over the process issues, is really successful with that. So those of you doing anything that touches compliance, you've got a great start. The next question is, if the learner's really interested in your content. So this is also a place where you could go micro. So I see some people saying, you know, I'm doing new hire orientation. Seriously, there is nobody more engaged with making sure they know what they're supposed to do, right, than those new hires, right? So those would be my first two questions. And I'm going to pause because I don't want to, like, go on and prattle on. If there's questions in the chat, or Brent and Chris, if you guys have comments.
I'm drawing a blank at the moment.
Okay. No, I can get more questions.
I love the sales product training. Caroline mentioned that's what she's working on. And that always struck me as a good place for micro learning to be effective, because you've got an audience of people that are traveling all the time. They're very short on time. Most of them are very short on patience, from my experience. Yep. And they don't want to take any time away. They'd rather be out selling.
Right.
Even when they know they need to learn a new product in order to sell it. You know, so giving them the small bits of information about the new product and roll it out over time, I think that's a really good place to get some value if you support that type of an audience.
Absolutely. And with that one, I think you can make the case that they probably fit within question number two there a little bit too, right? Like, they know they need this to sell better, but they just don't have time,
yeah.
Right? Yep, absolutely. So then let's see, next question is if this content is covered in depth somewhere else. So again, thinking about those different ways we can use micro learning, are you already doing it really well, say in a classroom? Because then you wanna consider micro for before or for after. Let's make sure that people are properly prepared when they come in and properly supported with reinforcement afterwards. So that can be a good place to go micro. And you don't have to, like you were saying, Brent, you don't have to upset the apple cart at all, right? You're like, yeah, we're going to keep doing what we're doing. I'm just going to add a little bit at the end, right? Easy.
Yep. Well, that's one of my biggest pushes these days in talking with folks about this kind of stuff and creating digital learning content is now more than ever, we have this ability to create multiple options for people. So, you know, I would say if you've got people that want to sit for a whole hour and do their compliance training, you should have a whole hour long course to let people just get it all out of the way in one shot. But then those people that don't want to do that and they want the 5-minute drip, you know, all year long, great. Let them choose that option and roll through that. Why not do both? You know, pick one or the other,
it's
or
true,
do
right?
both. You collect all the data on all of it. And, you know, as long as,
right.
Yeah.
Well, and to your point, I knew somebody who was collecting data on they were doing Epic training. So it was EMR, electronic medical records. So if anybody's in healthcare or in health sciences, probably familiar with that. Basically, it's a software that tracks every doctor's visit, every prescription, you know, all of that. And what they did was they were doing training on the software. So they were upgrading their system, and now this was all about how to use the tool more effectively. And if you can imagine, this is actually something that sparks fear in clinicians, right? They've got a patient who's sitting on the, maybe laying in the bed or sitting on the exam table, and they are sick and they are tired, and the last thing they want you to do is screw this up. Right? And it's the last thing any clinician wants too, but they want to be able to use that software really well, right? And they want to be able to do what they need to do. And so if they're clicking around and not able to use that software well while in front of a patient, it's really, you lose credibility. It creates this horrible situation.
Yeah. So they had. Let me call IT.
Right? Yeah, right. At the same time that I'm supposed to be writing your prescription or the lab tests or something, right? Yeah. So what she did actually, they were doing
it. Let me call someone.
Right? Exactly. And so really kind of, it's the kind of situation that learners are very, very kind of fearful in. And so she had little bits of training that were available right within the system, sort of like walk me sort of stuff, but a little bit more in depth. So little pieces of micro learning. And she offered different versions. And I'd have to double check my notes. I know the longest length was, I think, about 15 minutes, and the shortest length ones were about 2 to 3, and then there was a middle version, and they basically covered the same topics. So like, you've got the 2 to 3 minute version, probably about 7 minutes, and then 15 or so. And what she found was that the shortest ones, almost everyone who started them finished them. The middle ones, most people got to at least 80%. The 15 minute ones, people stopped early. And again, what they were finding was they were stopping. I'd have to double check my notes. It was somewhere around the 5 to 6 or less minute mark. So the point here is that they actually, based on that finding, they actually stopped doing anything longer than 7 to 10 minutes because they found people were bailing before the end of it anyway. So, yeah, so a nice plug for data.
I mean, it's something like that. It's just part of that. What am I trying to say, Chris? It's important to know, you know, if the information that they needed was actually just part of the front end stuff, and right. therefore the problem was solved versus attention span. I'll just flag that, you know.
Well, and I think what's interesting about that is, to me, it's less about, of course it's about attention span, but it's probably about getting back to priority number one. Right, which was the operational duty. And they may have really missed out on stuff. Like your point, Chris, like they may not have gotten all that they needed in this first part, but they just weren't willing to give any more time, which is also really interesting because we don't know what they lost out on.
Yeah.
It's interesting too. Oh, sorry, Chris, go ahead.
I was just going to say, just watching our time here, perhaps we should move to question four.
Question four, sure. You get me talking and I'll just go on and on here. Question number four is if the topic is forgotten when needed. So that's your case for performance support, right? And actually that example of Epic is the big training, but when they're in the moment, lab test, that's where the rubber meets the road, and that's why you do performance support. It's a type of microlearning. Now, the next question is if the change is related, or if the content is related to a change for the learner. So if anybody's familiar with change management, we want to have a series, a period of really getting them bought into the need to even change. So to be honest, training comes after that. If people aren't bought into doing it differently, it doesn't matter how good we do our job. And so change management, you can do little like commercials, little 2-minute things on like what's changing, why you might care about this, why this is better. And in some ways, they're almost like commercials. But the point is, you're actually changing their attitudes. You're changing their beliefs. And that is education, right? And so that's a really good place where micro fits well as well.
And that's where this conversation blends in nicely when we start talking about what are the similarities between what marketers do and what we do, right?
Right.
It's situations like that yes. it becomes very obvious that, oh, yeah, maybe we do need to be part of that process of influencing behavior change
right.
before we get to the actual training of knowledge and skills with the expertise that we all have. It's part of our job.
Yep. Yeah, interesting.
We often get focused as trainers or instructional designers on the knowledge aspect, but we often, as a result, overlook the opportunity to actually be there for the emotional, the affective. And that, that goes through to storytelling versus information presentation, all kinds of angles that we don't take advantage of often enough.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. And for me, I find it interesting because I think sometimes learning people are kind of like, oh, those marketing people, I don't want to be like them. But in many ways, I think our jobs are actually very similar. We are both trying to change someone's behavior. Mm-hmm. And that is the bottom line, right?
Yeah.
So I think there's tons of lessons to be learned from marketing, and marketers are also learning things from us. So yeah. And Donna, you're right. That's your ROI and your ROE, right? Your return on experience or expectations, right? You absolutely want people to think your training is valuable to them, because if it's not, even an hour of their time and they sit and be their, that button seat time, they didn't get anything out of it, right? You can't learn it for them. So to me, it's really important that we think about that part as well, the change management piece.
Yeah, for sure.
So then question number six, because I bet everybody's like on the edge of their seats going, this thing can't end without knowing number six. The last one is keeping your content, if it's important to keep your content top of mind. So that is often compliance actually fits in this category, but there's other topics as well. So like, are you trying to create something that's so automatic that people don't forget? So for example, one of my best examples is a personal one. I actually, a couple years ago, a friend had asked me to review a course for him. And I said, sure, I'm happy to do that. It was all about slips, trips, and falls, compliance training, right? And yeah. So I took it, and I was actually more engaged than probably anybody would be in this training because I was also reviewing it for a friend. And only about a week and a half later, I find myself on top of my kitchen cupboard, like cleaning the top of my fridge, doing my house cleaning stuff. And then you know where this is going, right? I jump off the counter, I like fall, I hurt myself actually pretty badly. 3 months later, my knee still hurts, right? And I'm like, I'm back. I took slips, trips, and falls.
Right? I should have known better.
I should have. Right. But the trouble was that even though I knew, it wasn't something that was on top of my mind at that moment. Right. And that's why we often see like posters around or, you know, factories often will have signs about their like how many days since they've had an incident, yeah. Stuff like that, because we want to keep it top of mind. And again, micro learning can fit there. Right. We can send them little bits over time or again, a quick PDF that throws in their inbox once a week or something like that. Right. Like, we should be thinking of, again, if for the performance change, I think some of these things become almost like the things that we are like, oh yeah, of course we would do that. But if we're only thinking about teaching content, we forget some of these things.
Yeah, the posters only go so far. I was in a store last week and they store extra stock on the very, very top shelf. And there's clearly labels. You know, staff only, you know, use a ladder or whatever. And the fellow who I asked where something was, he says, oh, it's over here, it's up there. And here's both of us, you know, reaching. He's doing the primary reaching, and I'm behind him to catch in case it falls. And it's like, as you were describing the counter, I'm thinking, yeah, there were two adults there, and neither of us really recognized the dumbness of, oh, well, it's, yeah, why get a ladder? It's right there. We can sort of reach it. Right. And literally, he's got enough, like, height for the fingertips over the shelf, and he's, like, wiggling it, sort of micro-wiggling it off, and we're like,
right?
It was not a heavy thing, thankfully. It was actually something relatively light, or I think we perhaps might not have been taking that same risk. But yeah, is it top of mind?
Right.
Sadly, we're all still human.
Right, exactly, right. We're not robots. But at the same time, yeah, keeping ourselves safe is important.
Yeah. I think all these questions are great. And it's such an easy way for us to think about what we need to do and how microlearning can help.
And I like the questions. They also give us a reason to talk to other people about why microlearning is valuable potentially in any of these cases. Yeah. It gives us a framework for not only just sort of assessing and making a decision, but also then bringing that, either the decision or the concept process, you know, forward into our organization as well. Jennifer has tossed a question into the official questions panel. Any tips on the best way we can organize this type, this just-in-time drip feed, if we don't have microlearning software /AI software to automate it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably the best examples I've seen are by email, doing email mm-hmm. campaigns. And, you know, even something like, you know, you can just set up an email box and send them on a schedule. You can schedule your emails before they go out. So an organization I worked at, we did it that way. You know, after you took the class, we actually set up all of the emails that were going to drip it right as soon as you had completed. And they were all set when they were supposed to. You can also use tools like MailChimp, which is, again, that's actually a tool that marketers use. Mm-hmm. And I think when we used that, we were paying very little money for it, or we had some free account.
Anything that sends notifications. I think people forget really the easiest. It doesn't, like, the feature doesn't say this is your micro learning feature as part of your LMS, right? But there are a ton of features that are built into different products and different systems. And one of them that I discovered was notifications, because the notifications within your LMS, those are already automated and they're already sending out. So mm-hmm. if you're going to be notifying people, why not also in your little email template add a little, either a link or a little video at the bottom, or just a statement, a reminder, or ask that question or something, right? Use that, you know, that opportunity that you're going to, that this notification is going to be going out to them anyways. Why not, you know, whatever the notification is, sure, obviously make that the big main topic, but then why not add a little something just in case they see it and it's another thing to just trigger some recall or some memory. So take advantage of the things that you have. That may not say micro learning on them, but you can be used for that.
And I like Jeff's comment in the chat as well. Like I'm pointing at the chat there, that you guys did it using your LMS, and just like you were saying, Brent, right? Whether it was with notifications or actually push emails from the LMS, you know, again, looking at the tools we already have. And Mark, I really like the comment you had there in the chat about how, you know, really micro learning is really just about how short and granular we're making the content. And we can share this in a ton of different ways. And so part of it is just about thinking about how different people are accessing content, you know, and that just requires us to kind of walk around our organizations and see how people are working. What are they using? Are they on a laptop every day? Or, you know, is this the thing that they're using all the time? Right. You've got lots of options.
Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have to be elaborate either. I mean, sometimes short and sweet. You know, if you're using email and you can convey the message in a bit of text, throw some, you know, emotional level in it, maybe a quick story or something like that. Well, then maybe you didn't have to make a video. Maybe you didn't have to go and create, you know, a full on web page to link to. And it also, the more steps that there are involved in accessing the actual content becomes itself also potentially a deterrent then. You know, people open up an email and now they've got to click a link and they're going to wait for something else to load and da, da, da. Well, that's also potentially a challenge for actually getting the point across, is literally that people have to wait for it and you're giving more people chances to bail out. Oh, wait a minute. Now we're getting back into marketing again, aren't we?
Right.
Yeah. And it's funny that what you were talking about earlier, I think users build their own micro learning by taking our hour long learning and only watching it 5 minutes at a time, right? I mean, one of the biggest, when I was working in the LMS world, one of the biggest suggestions that they had was, we want to be able for people to come back, right? Can you, when they get to a certain point in your course and they leave, when they come back, can you have them just pick up where they left off, or do they have to start all over again, right? And I started thinking about that. I'm like, you know what? They're asking for that because the users are requesting it, because they're slicing and dicing that super long content themselves. They're choosing to micro your macro content.
Right. And I think
we can help them.
Right, exactly, right? We could be more thoughtful about that. And I think to Chris's point, you made an awesome point about the emails. Like, you don't want to send an email that has tons of content and maybe a link out. You know, the most effective ones I've seen have a couple of sentences, maybe a paragraph, you know, reminding you, hey, in class, we learned about this. Have you thought about X, Y, and Z? A couple of bullets, and then we're done. Because nobody reads a long email, right? It's about something really quick and targeted.
Yep.
For sure.
And that's kind of a good description of idiotic as we reach our end of our time. Oh, isn't that a great transition?
Yeah, good segue.
Yeah, we're quick and targeted as well as idiotic. So, Carla, awesome to have you here. Those are great questions. And thanks to Jack, who's been tossing them in as a summary in the checklist. I'll be going back and writing them down. Give us another showing of your book just so that that folks can get a refresher on that. And before we depart, also some info on where people can find you. Now, is that the new book or is that the previous book?
That's the current book. That's the one that's available on Amazon. We are working on another one right now. Yep.
Yep. You've got another one in the pipeline coming this summer, is it?
In time for Christmas, maybe a little after.
Okay. There we go.
And I'm putting my email address in the chat. So if anybody wants to ask any other questions, I think, Jennifer, you had a question that was pretty targeted. Anyone want to ask me some questions? I'm happy to help.
Yeah. If you're in the Ottawa area, join us June 21. We have a live idiotic happening, ABCs of XAPI. join us for the morning of Friday, June 21. Ping us if you want info about that. We can get that info to you if you're able to join that. Mark says he would go to Ottawa for that. So Mark, we'll ping you afterwards, tell you a bit more about it, show you the link. And if it's not up your alley, Mark, don't hesitate to share it with other folks too. So very cool. Thanks, guys. Let's roll the music.
Thanks, everyone.
Crank it up.